our positions of the map.
Now, that whole bridge, all this coal mine stuff, is coming from the single-player level that it was, in my opinion, the hardest aspect of the single-player, where you are playing as a character with David and fighting off all the infected that come in here. It's a very memorable moment in the game for me.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a really cool fight, and so we took that space, that bridge area, right, where all the infected were dropping in, and we used that as a kind of key connecting structure in the map.
Totally. This interior area with all the generators and stuff is kind of reminds me a little bit of the dam with the turbines up on the top bridge area.
Absolutely. Gateville-wise, it's actually kind of similar to that too. It's a figure eight structure.
Right.
It creates some really cool setups. Knows a guy that's there.
And the dam is my favorite map from retail as well.
Decide to bail there. That's a good idea. Just getting
surrounded. I liked a lot of the natural cover, the rocks and such. And ooh.
Well, looks like he's getting flanked.
People are asking, is this Lakeside Part 2?
A question from the Twitch stream: is this map Lakeside Part 2? You know, it's
hold
you
on.
Look at it that way, but it's pretty different actually in the way it plays because it has those much tighter interior spaces as well. So Lakeside is generally all outside with just a couple small interiors. And this map is, you know, quite a bit more varied, and it's also got that verticality element to it, where you've got these big hills and you've got the bridge. So it plays pretty differently.
Spiritual successor is, I think, more of the right terminology for how it relates to Lakeside. And also, we'll be seeing environmental effects kind of similar to Lakeside, correct?
Yeah, so on this side, there's all this fog and snow that comes in.
Beautiful!
And so this map, there's a snowstorm that kicks up. Well, it's in trouble.
Hurry up! We're out of time! So we don't have
use some single-player maps, like the hotel or the hospital or something like that.
So just briefly to finish off the snowstorms, there is a snowstorm that comes up in this map, and it's a little different than the Lakeside one, though. It's less foggy and it's more snowy, so there's a lot more kind of snow flurries that happen, and it doesn't obscure your vision to quite the same distance, and it's a little more atmospheric. We had a question from the Twitch stream about how come we didn't use some of the other single-player environments like the hospital. We certainly prototype some of those spaces. One of our other designers actually started a prototype, but ultimately, you know, we decided to pick spaces that we felt would translate best into gameplay. And some of those spaces, like the hospital, were, you know, extremely heavy on the interiors and multiple floors and stuff, and you know, they didn't work as well. So
we pick locations that really lend themselves to good combat or good gameplay, because ultimately our multiplayer is about our gameplay, and we want to pick the best, you know, locations possible. Ooh, nice snipe.
Yeah, so you can see here this outdoor area is a little longer slight lines.
One less word.
Oh, get the launcher.
Nice.
I think the launcher's got to be my favorite gun in the new DLC.
It's a great gun. It's just very situational. You have to use it very carefully to make use of it.
Like that. yes. That has got to be the best execution ever.
So when you have on a silencer, will somebody with the awareness skill be able to hear it?
Question for the Twitch stream is, if you're using a silencer, does someone using the awareness skill hear the silencer? There's no difference, actually, in how the awareness affects the sounds of silenced weapons. You're going to be able to hear them the same distance as any other player. They're still going to not show up on the radar for those players. What awareness really gives you is that visibility in the space of can you spot who the enemies are quickly in that space. A lot of players, you know, if you're not sitting super close to your TV, you might have trouble spotting a small enemy that's only partially exposed, and awareness just gives you that name tag and lets you see them a lot more easily.
I got you.
Oh, that's not good.
What's going on, execution rampage?
Vivian, kicking ass. It's so hard to use the flamethrower too. That's a pro right there.
So, another question. Are we doing anything to this full auto rifle in the patch? Is it being changed at all?
What was the question?
It's a new weapon. It's not being changed.
There was a question from the Twitch stream about the full auto rifle being, is it being changed in the patch? It's a new weapon, so it's not it's being changed at all. This is the first time it's being released.
They're probably confusing it with the assault rifle.
Maybe they're thinking of the assault rifle, which has not been changed. It's it's the same as it was before. So what's Quentin going to do here?
By the way, a big shout out to our QA team who are just showing some really professional playing right here.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, they're good players.
So the smoke bomb vault exploit, they're calling it.
So there you see that he's using awareness, and that player who had attacked him, he saw where that player was going because that player's name tag was following them for 10 seconds here. So the other part of the skill helping you. Ah, somebody's trying to snipe from the bridge. Bridge is definitely a key sniping position.
It's gonna be awesome to put some drop some bombs right up at the top of that thing, unless you're using your listen mode and watching out for
that. So you can see he's comboed in his loadout, his combo damage marker for the launcher. So when he marked that, when he hit that target with the explosion, it actually marked the target as well, which is really useful.
Do we have a question?
So the smoke bomb vaults exploit, people are calling it. Did we do anything to fix that
match? I'm empty!
Question about the smoke bomb
smoke
vault exploit from the stream. We talked about this last stream, and yes, that is indeed fixed in this patch. So it was a bug. If you're in the middle of a vault animation, you're immune to a smoke bomb stun, and that's been fixed. And so now what will happen is you'll actually you kind of warp back to the very beginning of your vault instantly and go into the stun immediately. So smoke bombs are still effective against vaulting players.
Hold on, I can patch you up.
Have we seen the flurry yet? I really want to see that flurry.
Yeah.
Oh, it already happened.
I think it already happened. This Kuma's probably inside, I think.
Yeah.
Some of that is going on. Wow, this is a close game.
Yeah, the cool thing is, even though like it you know, it's very similar to Lakeside, it still you can still tell a very, very huge difference between the two maps. I don't think people will ever, you know, get confused between the two maps, you know, at all. Especially with a lot more like kind of industrial
keep an eye out
stuff like these trucks and machinery and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So Clint's trying to gear up his launcher here, just reloaded. Where is he gonna use it?
Keep an eye out.
Got it. People on the bridge.
Can he get that off?
So he's gonna try and go up there and shoot into the bridge, which is a small area, so he'll probably get a lot of splash damage.
Oh, nice. Did that guy fall down? Oh, he went down.
I think he jumped down.
He jumped down right as he got hit.
So that's the only cool thing about the bridge, is if you're in trouble, you can just bail and jump out the window there.
I still heard the he took damage, though, even though he was vaulting out.
That's true, yeah.
The splash will come. Oh, beautiful. Q-Trait. That's my second favorite execution right there. After that awesome launcher execution.
Yeah, that's great.
So Aaron, you weren't here for the question, but what's your favorite map of the new Reclaimed Territories map pack?
Sure, everyone's always partial to the maps they design.
Of course, of course.
I love playing Coal Mines as well.
Same.
But I actually think Worf might be
I was torn. I was like, oh man, is it Worf or is it Coal Mine? I went Coal Mine, but Worf's which we're going to show off next. Yeah.
I'm going to see that one next. It's a really tight short range map with a lot of stealth opportunities.
Machete.
I mean, like, I love playing stealth and sneaking around and trying to get shift kills.
Yeah.
And Worf is great for that.
It's awesome.
Got a question. Does damage marker penetrate covert training 3?
So the question for the Twitch stream was, does the damage marker skill work against covert training? So if you've got covert training 3 that prevents you from being marked, and then somebody else has damage marker and they damage you, do you get marked? And no, you do not. Covert training 3 still prevents you from getting marked, and the player with damage marker still gets a notification saying, sorry, you can't mark this player, they've got covert training. So if you want to be super stealthy and never get marked, you can still set covert training 3 and use it.
Oh boy, this is going to be interesting.
Nine
times.
One less dragon.
He wasn't ready for that fireman squad right there. Oh, he's got the. Alright, nice.
Surprised that guy didn't use his upgrade.
Exactly what I saw. Yeah, that nice little sparkle.
I guess he had two players attacking him, so
yeah,
would have been tough.
So we got another question that's kind of a compliment, but they want to know how we design our spawning points, and they think they're really well done. So.
Thank you.
We had a question from the Twitch stream about the spawn system and how we design the spawn points. And they like them, which is good. We've actually improved the spawning, actually, in this patch. We've had some problems in the past, especially on maps like Billstown, where like two players would die, and then they would respawn at the end of the map very close together. And so we've put in a fix for that, and they will spawn much further away now. So we've made some improvements overall to the spawn system, but it's still working fairly well. And it works pretty much.
Flamethrower.
So the way it works is there's kind of spawn points around the map in a ring, and they're all weighted differently based on a bunch of different factors, like are your allies close to them, are there enemies close to them that are going to downweight them, you don't want to spawn there, are there dead allies that are going to have just recently been killed, you don't want to spawn there, so those get downweighted, so there's a whole bunch of different weights, and there's an algorithm that picks the points with the highest weights.
That guy messed up, he had the upgraded.
Yeah, he had the upgraded, but he didn't use it.
So we've answered this question quite a few times, but it's always good to repeat it. Why aren't there any infected in multiplayer?
So you can see Quentin using the sniper position there from the bridge, trying to spot if the enemies had spawned down there. That would have been a good spot to kind of
hold them back
as they were coming up. Question from the Twitch stream about why are there no infected in multiplayer? This question we've answered many times. I didn't get the stun off. So we certainly would love to try and experiment with some of that stuff, but there are some huge technical issues there preventing us. Specifically memory, we're really pushing the PS3 to its limit, and there's just not enough memory to have NPCs in the map along with all these human players.
Right.
In addition, there's all the kind of CPU overhead of running all these NPCs at the same time as running all these human players. So
and then balancing gameplay as well.
Yeah, so technically there was some huge barriers there. Not to mention there's the time investment in trying to create that experience.
We definitely looked into it, trust us. We wanted that too, really bad.
We did. Ultimately, I think though, because we focused on a smaller, set of modes, we were able to really, get them to a point where they were delivering that kind of survival aspect that we wanted to the game.
A really good core gameplay.
Yeah, capturing the core gameplay and the tone that we were after. Cool, so we're gonna go to the next map now, and I'll introduce Quentin Cobb, designer of the map. He's gonna come talk to you about Worf.
Thank you, Aaron. All right, so the man who's been playing for the last three maps, Quentin Cobb, game designer at Naughty Dog.
Yep.
Been balancing the guns and everything in the multiplayer, so... all right, Aaron's going to take over now, playing on your map, Worf.
That's right.
From Star Trek right now. Now, this is... but first, actually, before we talk about the map, let's talk about the new loadout that we're going to be running through here.
Yeah, so Aaron's going to be using revolver, semi-auto, and because Worf is kind of a close range, there's a lot of flank routes. He's going to take Sharp Ears 3. And what else? I can't remember what else. Sharp Ears 3, Cover Training 2, and Agility 3. So he'll be invisible to listen mode while he's crouched. He'll be moving faster while in listen mode because of Sharp Ears 3. And he'll have more listen mode meter. And he'll be moving around the map faster and silently.
And he'll be using the revolver and the semi-auto.
Yeah, so he'll be a super ninja moving around Worf.
So now Worf is my second favorite map from this map pack, and that's what Aaron said as well. The smallest map, but it's still large. But it's of the four that we're releasing, this is the smallest of them. But it has some amazing gameplay, some really tight corridors, but also some exterior areas, some length for some long range shooting and stuff. But the reason that we're picking this kind of ninja loadout is for this gameplay, and we'll show that off here once this map gets going.
Yeah, Worf is actually based off of the docks section of single player where you...
The very beginning.
Beginning of the map, right. Beginning of the map, the beginning of the game when you're with Tess and you first spot Robert in Military City, go after him, and it's essentially that section of the map.
Talk about this boat real quick.
Okay, so there's a giant boat in the middle of the map that's probably the most iconic landmark here, and you can actually go into the boat.
Nice headshot.
Yeah, nice shooting, and it's a great way to flank your opponents, because you can go in the middle and there's a lot of options out of the boat into the rest of the map. So now Aaron has a lot of different options. He's got enemies on his right and some teammates over there. And so he's in the center boat and he could actually go right and creep around. Oh, something behind him. Someone's on the boat too.
Nice.
Well done. So, yeah, the boat is, it's definitely sort of tower position of the map, because there's so many options to come out and get around enemies.
It gives you access to a lot of the flow of the map. So that'll probably be a very high tension point for a lot of players and teams that they're playing.
Definitely. Oh, so close. Oh, nice.
Wow, last second.
There you go. Oh, he's real low on everything. So this is the, where he's at now is the side, the dock side of the map where...
You're facing out towards the water.
Facing out towards the water, and the side cache is here. There's plenty of ammo, that's good. And actually, this section of the docks you couldn't get to in single player, so actually flesh that out. See how Aaron's moving around with Sharp Ears 3 and agility super quickly and silently. To get sweet shift kill.
Sweet.
Nice job.
Well deserved.
So that really showed off agility and, I mean, the whole loadout. Agility, covert training, and Sharp Ears 3.
Right. And it really just goes to show, again, like how important listen mode is for these kind of tight maps.
Yeah. Yeah, Sharp Ears is great for Worf because it's kind of a more compressed, condensed map with lots of routes in and out. So that listen mode would be super useful. It's also got a lot of verticality. There's a lower area, there's an upper area of the boat, and so right now you're on the top section of the boat.
Shout out to Andres Rodriguez, the environment artist on this map. He did a phenomenal job. This whole boat was his idea. Like, there was a smaller boat originally.
Yeah, originally there was, I used the small boat that was in single player that you couldn't get onto. It was raised.
Right.
So I dropped that down and let you go in and out of it. But it
was,
oh no!
That was awesome.
There's machete versus plank there. Machete won. And a gnarly...
Brutal
execution. But yeah, Andres actually built a whole nother boat from scratch, and it's way better for gameplay. Yeah, huge shout out to him. He did a phenomenal job on this map.
It goes back to what I was saying about how, like, how collaborative Nighthawk is about our, you know, multiplayer, and how everybody can just contribute, and it comes out, we try to make the best products possible, best maps, best experiences.
Yeah, so right now he's on the container side of the map. And we'll see which way he goes. There's a whole office section that we haven't been to yet. And the back of the boat area.
Right.
Which has like kind of shanty town, sort of military city sort of look to it to differentiate it from the rest of the map. So here he's going in the middle, kind of in front of the large boat, and heading over towards the left flank and like the office area.
Yeah, so there's the offices here, over here to the left.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is the other side of the map, other opposite of the
kind of the warehouse.
Side. Yeah, it's like warehouse offices, and then to the back is the back docks area where he's headed now.
So two-part question for you, real quick, Quentin. What is your favorite map in this map pack, and also what is your favorite new gun?
As other people have stated, I'm a little biased. I love Worf.
Yeah.
Not just because I designed it, but I think it just turned out
great. Right.
It looks amazing. The lighting's incredible.
I love this flickering light.
Yeah, really, I mean, moody. some of the it's like a darker area with a light. Let's see what Aaron does here. So
nice.
A little stun Molotov.
He didn't get the down though.
So this is the office area.
Is that armor?
So Worf is probably my favorite map. I love Coal Mine as well. It's also a great map. My favorite gun is the Spectre.
The Spectre.
Yeah, I love that it's a silent, automatic weapon. Oh, he got caught. He's being revived. Oh no, that's somebody else, sorry. One of his teammates would revive, it just looked like it was him.
Right.
But the Spectre is definitely my favorite weapon. It unloads so fast, it's silent, and the reload animation is actually one of my favorites. It's done by our resident amazing animator Tal Peleg.
He did our awesome Joel Banderas.
He did the Joel Banderas. Yeah, he did that like little gif. Oh, Shiv time. But the wheel animation on the Spectre is super cool. I just love how fast and quick it can take somebody out silently. It's definitely my favorite weapon.
So we're getting a lot of questions about agility and
yes.
We feel like it's going to be too overpowered and like how we balanced it and that sort of thing.
Okay, so from the Twitch stream, people are concerned about agility. Agility 3 will increase your walk speed, your crouch walking speed, which you can see here, Aaron is crouch walking. That's the top speed that you can go. It's faster, but it's not, you're not flying around the map. And it also increases your climbing speed. Oh, nice. Shivering for days. And it also decreases the sound, the footfalls sound that you make, and completely eliminates your Vox like efforts. So if you drop from a high ledge, you normally will go, but Agility 3 will actually completely eliminate those, so you move around silently and your character doesn't. Ooh, there's the Spectre. That's what I'm talking about.
Nice.
But agility is great for if you want to be a full, like a full ninja and no one can hear you and you're moving very quickly. But we spent a lot of time balancing all of these skills. And I think agility for the loadout points that it costs and the amount of speed that you're getting, it's definitely balanced with the rest of the skills.
Awesome. So what do you think, other than, are there like areas in this map that players are going to kind of map control it besides the boat? Or is like the boat going to be like the main one? Will there be like a counter to that? Or
The boat will allow you to get to all the different, the front, the back, and both sides of the map quickly, so it's kind of a really advantageous place to be. Somebody on the side. But there's actually a couple of sort of sniper perches on the inside near the warehouse that are actually a really good control point to kind of get a vision over those areas. Maybe Aaron can take a peek at those to give people a preview of that. There's a lot of action up here, though. But yeah, I would say, you know, the center boat and maybe some of the sniper perches are definitely places you want to try to control during your match. And of course, the item cache.
Oh,
wow. Vivian and the flamethrower.
Vivian
okay.
is killing it.
But the item caches, of course, are,
of course,
are
yeah.
power positions and areas you want to control the map as well, so you can keep those items.
Is there an item cache in the boat?
There is in Survivors.
Okay.
So in Survivors, we have a center cache, and it's actually in that center boat room in the upper area where Aaron went in the beginning of the map.
Awesome.
So that's the center cache. So that's in Survivors for sure. That's a point you want to control. Vivian again. The nemesis. Oh, there's someone right next to you. Oh no! Oh, shit! Alright, a little bit of panic, but that's okay.
We forgive you, Aaron. Is that the Enforcer?
Ooh, that's the Enforcer. Vivian nice. Is the Flamethrower Enforcer. She's going to town. Any other questions from Twitch stream, Eric, that are.
Yeah, there's a lot of questions about. Showing grounded mode, which I think we'll get to, but trophies are the biggest
one. So we're going to get to the trophies and talk a little more about grounded here in a bit. This match is almost over, and we're going to show off the trophies right after this. We'll go through that.
Yeah, we'll go over the trophies right after this match. Actually, Aaron's getting to one of the sniper perches.
Oh, there we go. Yeah, perfect.
So you can see what kind of view he has.
Nice.
Got a nice kill. The last
there we go.
Kill.
Well done.
And the other question that came up quite a bit was the new gestures we were showing off.
Yeah.
What are those all about?
So the new gesture that I was doing in the other maps was called Big Time. And it's actually replaced the Knuckles gesture. And it's, you just gotta get your shine on sometimes. So, okay, we'll go over the new trophies here. They're pretty basic, they're pretty straightforward. Let me get past all the other trophies. Okay, so we actually have a trophy for each of the new maps, each of the DLC maps. So We have a trophy called Wharf, and you just have to complete a match on Wharf without dying and getting at least 3 downs or executions.
It's pretty tough.
Yeah, pretty tough. So you basically have to get have a perfect game and get at least 3 kills. That's the same for all of the new maps. You just have to complete the match without dying and getting at least 3 downs and executions in any game mode. And then we also have Recovered Supply Raider, Recovered Survivalist, and Recovered Interrogator. And these are for completing a game of on Supply Raid in any of the new maps. So you just have to complete the game in this mode on any new map and you get this trophy. Pretty straightforward. Same with Recovered Survivalist, just completing a game in Survivors and completing a game in Interrogation. And we also have the same set of trophies for DLC 1.
Right.
Bookstore is the map that you designed. That's excellent. So the trophy Bookstore is just for completing a match on Bookstore without dying and getting at least 3 downs and executions.
Good luck.
Yeah, good luck. So same for all 4 of the DLC 1 maps. You just have a trophy for completing a match without dying. So you got to really play super defensively and carefully, and you got to get 3 kills, so you just can't camp out in the corner. Mm-hmm. You have to actually engage and survive.
Right.
And then we have Forsaken Supply Raider, Forsaken Survivalist, and Forsaken Interrogator. These are all for completing a game on each mode in DLC 1, in one of the DLC 1 maps. So any of those maps, Bookstore, Hometown, Suburbs, or Bus Depot, you just have to complete a game of Supply Raid, complete a game of Survivors, and complete a game of Interrogation. So you get those trophies. The last 2 trophies are for Grounded Mode, and those are pretty straightforward as well. Just the complete Grounded Mode, which is going to be very difficult to do, and then you have to go back and complete Grounded Mode again on New Game Plus. So that's it for the trophies.
They're awesome. Yeah. Challenging.
They're challenging, yeah. but pretty straightforward and not too complicated. I think everyone should have a pretty good chance of completing those if you really put the time in. Any other questions?
One of the other questions was, what's the story to the different maps? I think we went over some of the stories, but it'd be cool maybe just a quick recap of what each of the maps, you know, what they mean in single player and how you guys brought
them. Sure.
So the question is kind of like, what's the story behind all the maps of the new DLC? So we have Capital, which is based off of Boston level, where you and Tess are
trying to meet the Fireflies.
You have Ellie, you're trying to get her to them. And then we won't make any spoils for anybody who hasn't played single player, but
play single player.
That's where that ungrounded mode, which we'll talk about here in a minute as well.
Yeah.
Water Tower is the preliminary area of Billstown in Lincoln, Pennsylvania. So you're kind of like exploring the kind of empty town. Coal Mine is, again, that's where you first meet David. I don't want to spoil too much stuff because that's a big character in the game.
Yeah.
But if you remember,
Ellie.
And you fight all those infected that come in. It's like one of the hardest battles in the whole game.
Yeah.
And then finally, Wharf
is the docks from Military City. And actually, the theme that I was thinking about for this level is that, so after Joel and Tess kill Robert, and all of his men leave that area, all the people from Military City start to sort of kind of migrate into the docks area, and that's why that back section of the boat and docks area is like, has a bunch of sort of, it's like a town, it's like a, it's like a shanty town, thank you, Aaron. And so that's kind of the story there, and that like a lot of people from Military City move there, and but yeah, it's based off docks from single player.
Awesome. All right, I think that's about it. Thank you guys so much for joining us today. This is just our first kind of foray again into our Twitch streaming and community outreach. So please, again, leave feedback for us of what you guys want to see in the future. Jump over to NaughtyDog.com onto our forums and let us know what you want to see. Tomorrow, our new DLC comes out, and you'll be able to get the Reclaimed Territories map pack as well as the new skills bundles or individually and our new weapons. So. Thanks again. Give us a follow on Twitch as well, and come join us back for more in the future.